إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإن عاقبتم فعاقبوا بمثل ما عوقبتم به ولئن صبرتم لهو خير للصابرين وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم صل من قطعك اعف عمن ظلمك وأحسن إلى من أساء إليك أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام Honorable Ulama Ikram, respected brothers and elders, one of the greatest tragedies of our times is that the most evil and immoral people have become role models and have become celebrities. A person has a certain skill in a sporting field, he becomes a sporting star, youth flock towards him, embrace him, revere him, emulate him, yet that very sporting star's social life is in total shambles. And we see the media features this from time to time. There is only one human whose life has been molded and groomed to perfection on every possible level, and that is the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ Indeed, there is a perfect example and a perfect role model for you. Any human coming from any background at any point can relate to the life of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are many people that are, you know, they are excellent as far as their own sphere and field is concerned. Perhaps a brilliant businessman, but a hopeless father. A wonderful cricketer, but a terrible neighbor. He will excel in a certain thing and he will fall short in a certain thing. Any aspect of the life of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you will examine it, Nabi alayhi salam himself said, أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي My Allah himself tutored me and my Allah himself nurtured me and hence my Allah perfected my nurturing. It is Allah that says in the Quran, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ And O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we endorse the fact that you possess sublime character. وَإِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ Most definitely you are from amongst the prophets. وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ And you steer people towards guidance. In fact, it can safely be said that the salient qualities of the various prophets were the common qualities in the life of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And hence it was by virtue of this sublime character of his that he molded the most barbaric of nations in a short span of 23 years and made them guiding stars for humanity till the day of Qiyamah. With the loss of minimum lives in a short span of 23 years, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam molded the most barbaric nations. And every quality of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was responsible for attracting people towards Islam. And the beauty of the character of Nabi alayhi salam is such that up to this day, those qualities of Nabi alayhi salam, which attracted and captured the hearts of the most staunch kuffar, those qualities and attributes still possess the same effect till today. Hence, if the ummah today will reflect the beauty of Islam, I swear by Allah, the media will have no choice while they harp and they create an anti-Islamic sentiment. If the Muslims have to inculcate within them the beautiful akhlaq of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without taking out any article, without coming publicly on any radio station, nationally or internationally, but prove the media wrong by virtue of their character. For example, the beautiful quality of generosity in the life of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, what a remarkable quality. Like I said, hasunat jami'u khisalihi. Every quality of his was unique. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is walking, a kafir by the name of Safwan ibn Umayyah. Nabi alayhi salam is walking in a valley, he has some sheep with him, there is some cattle, and Nabi alayhi salam with him, he herds this particular herd in a direction. A kafir by the name of Safwan ibn Umayyah is impressed at the wealth of Nabi alayhi salam. فَأَدَامَ النَّذْرَ وَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَرْمُقُهُ He's really staring, he's admiring, he's obsessed, he's envying Nabi alayhi salam. Nabi alayhi salam looked at him and said, Safwan, you like what you see? He says, I really love what I see. Nabi alayhi salam says, have it then. Take the sheep, take the cattle, whatever. He says, do you literally mean? I mean, if a man is driving a beautiful car and you admire it, you say, that's the closest you can get to it is admiring it. There's nothing closer you can get to my car than other than admiring it. Nabi alayhi salam says, take the sheep and go. He becomes so impressed, he goes back to his nation, he says, Ya qawm aslimu, fawallahi inna muhammadan layu'ti ata'an. When he seen this act of generosity, the first statement he uttered, he said, I swear by Allah, no human can do this other than the heart of a prophet. I swear by ma tabat nafsu ahadin bihada illa nafsu nabiyin. It needs a prophet to make a declaration like this and to be so generous. He goes back to his people, he says, oh my people, accept Islam. I promise you, this man hasn't come to take your money, he has come to give you money. So every quality of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was unique and outstanding. Today I only want to explore one quality in the life of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And really we all have lot to learn from this particular quality of Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam. And that was the Nabi of Allah, what a forgiving human he was. To forgive, to overlook, to pardon. Until and unless this quality will not become part of our marriages, wallah, those marriages will not see prosperity. In any argument, if a husband and wife will dwell on the past and revive the wrong of the past, it will only jeopardize that relation. But let us see how broad is the bosom and the chest of Nabi alayhi salam, that he can forgive and pardon and give shelter to people that you know, who have committed crimes that were, wallah, unpardonable. Let's look at, for example, the conquest of Makkah, which indeed was the pinnacle manifestation of the quality of forgiveness in the life of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He leaves from Medina Munawwara on the 10th of Ramadan after Asr Salah with an army of 10,000 Sahaba. And he kept it a secret so that the Kuffar cannot make counter preparations. He plans the invasion of Makkah precisely in accordance to the time that Allah had decided. The first setback that he faces was from one of his own near dear companions, and that is a Sahabi by the name of Hatib ibn Abi Balta radiallahu anhu, who was a loyal, faithful Sahaba, but had some non-Muslim relatives in Makkah. While he was notified of the agenda of Nabi alayhi salam, he was overpowered by sentiments that what is going to happen to his family in Makkah. He writes a brief note, he gives it to one woman, and he says, get to Makkah quickly, notify my relative that the Nabi of Allah has intended invade in Makkah, they must make their preparations. This woman takes the letter and she proceeds. Jibreel Amin descends and tells Nabi alayhi salam, and the verses are revealed in Surah Mumtahina, that O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of your companions have intended to divulge your secrets, and this is the whereabouts. You can make adequate arrangements to intercept this woman. Nabi alayhi salam says, Nabi alayhi salam called Ali radiallahu anhu, Miqdad ibn Aswad and Abu Marthad. Nabi alayhi salam said, get onto your horses and gallop it as fast as you can. You come to this precise location, hatta ta'tu rawzata khakhin. There is a woman there, she has valuable information, intercept her in that letter and bring it back. This woman was brought back, the letter was brought. And when the letter was opened, clearly in very bold handwriting, this is from Hatib ibn Abi Balta to the people of Makkah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam intends invading, make preparations. Nabi alayhi salam says, call the Sahabi. Sayyidina Umar said, O Nabi of Allah, let's not call and delay the matter. If a man can betray you, why not behead him? Nabi alayhi salam said, calm down, O Umar. Allah reveals the verses, لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء تلقون إليهم بالمودة. He says, O Nabi of Allah, hear me out. Look at the patience of Nabi alayhi salam. O Nabi of Allah, hear me out. Inni kafarat, inni aslamtu. O Nabi of Allah, I'm a Muslim and I'm a genuine Muslim. Ma kafartu walartadattu. I have not abandoned you, neither have I become renegade. I became emotional over the sentiments of my family, and because of that I divulge your secret, but I still love you and I revere you, and I acknowledge what I did was totally wrong, but I realized that immediately revelation had informed you, and my agenda and my plan failed. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam heard the Sahabi and he said, I have forgiven you, and oh my Sahaba, you also forgive him, nobody can harass him. Nabi alayhi salam resumes the journey. They come to a place called Dhil Hulayfa. This is the month of Ramadan after Asr Nabi alayhi salam departs. The kuffar of Makkah have absolutely no information. They come to Dhil Hulayfa. From Makkah, Abbas radiallahu anhu leaves to make hijrat. Abbas, the uncle of Nabi alayhi salam, had accepted Islam, but Nabi alayhi salam told him that you stay in Makkah, disguise your Islam, and then inform me on the movements of the kuffar. When he comes to Dhul Hulayfa, Nabi alayhi salam said that, oh Abbas, your hijrat is final. Now we are going back to Makkah, and you also join us and return. The kuffar, there was a general perception in Makkah that at the conquest of Makkah, either you embrace Islam or you flee for your safety. Now, there's no other option. Either you come to this man, admit all your wrong, ask for forgiveness, embrace his life, or then you flee for safety. As Nabi alayhi salam came to Makkah, and when the kuffar seen this huge army around Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, it was too late for them to even notify, never mind make preparations. Two of Nabi alayhi salam's cousins, who played a vital role against Nabi alayhi salam, they came close to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam to ask for forgiveness. One was Nabi alayhi salam's cousin, his uncle's son, and one was Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's auntie's son. Nabi alayhi salam said, I don't want to see them, tell them they mustn't come close to me. Nabi alayhi salam's wife, Umm Salma radiallahu anha, was what? She interceded, she said, O Nabi of Allah, ibn ammik wa ibn ammatik. After all, they are your cousins, why don't you hear them out? Nabi alayhi salam accepted the intercession of Umm Salma. Those two cousins came, they sincerely apologized. The Nabi of Allah said, okay, I have pardoned you. In this manner, many people came, Nabi alayhi salam forgave them, and then he came into Makkah. All gaze on Nabi alayhi salam entering as the conqueror of Makkah. Unlike how kings and monarchs enter, like the Quran says, إِنَّ الْمُلُوكَ إِذَا دَخَلُوا قَرْيَةً أَفْسَدُوهَا وَجَعَلُوا أَعِزَّةَ أَهْلِهَا أَذِلَّةً. That when a tyrant ruler comes into any place, as we seen the invasion in Iraq, we seen what is happening, what might, what authority, what pride, what arrogance. Nabi alayhi salam enters into Makkah, all the gazes are on him. Riwayat suggests he did not even lift his gaze, he dropped it totally out of modesty. Attributing it to Allah. Alhamdulillah alladhi anjaza wa'ada. All praise belongs to Allah who fulfilled his promise. Anjaza wa'ada, nasara abda, who assisted his servant. Hazamal ahzaba wahda, and gave defeat to all the enemies of Islam. Nabi alayhi salam comes to the house of Umm Hani radiallahu anha. He takes ghusl, he comes to the Kaaba, he performs 2 rakat namaz. Sahaba ikram, can we imagine the sense of jubilation amongst the Sahaba and joy at the conquest of Makkah? Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gathers the kuffar in Makkah, they all congregate here. He then asks an open question to the congregation, given the atrocities that they had carried out against Nabi alayhi salam. Nabi alayhi salam says, O people, what do you think today I will decide with you? They all said, we beseech you, we implore you to overlook the wrong we displayed to you. Nabi alayhi salam said, I will echo the sentiments of my brother Yusuf. When Allah reunited him with his brothers, because of the wrong of his brothers, he was separated. What did he say? لا تثريب عليكم اليوم يغفر الله لكم وهو أرحم الراحمين. There is no reproach on you. I have forgiven all of you, and my dua is, may Allah also forgive you. Go, you are free for the pleasure of Allah. At this critical juncture, after there was general pardon, the Nabi of Allah gave a declaration that 15 kuffar must be beheaded wherever they are. One was a general pardon to one and all, but there were 15 elements of evil in society who the Nabi of Allah said, wherever you see them, behead them. One of them was Abdullah ibn Khatal, and this is what I want to draw your attention to. Abdullah ibn Khatal was a kafir who initially was a Muslim. He accepted Islam. Nabi alayhi salam had sent him out to receive some zakat from certain tribes. And with him, Nabi alayhi salam sent another young sahabi. So when they came to that location, Abdullah bin Khatal told this young boy, okay, you prepare the food, I will go and collect the money, the zakat. He agreed, and subsequently Abdullah bin Khatal went. This young boy, young, tender age, he fell off to sleep. He was in deep sleep, overpowered by tiredness. When Abdullah bin Khatal came back, and he found that this man was sleeping, he got so angry, that in a fit of anger, he killed the man. Brothers, don't ever underestimate the harm of anger and lust. When a man is overpowered by lust, never mind zina, he will perpetrate the act of incest, and we see it happening around us. And when a man is overpowered by anger, then just because of the delay of one meal, he will kill a man. He killed him immediately, he realized, I did a blunder, the Nabi of Allah will take revenge and he will kill me also. So he abandoned Islam and he became a kafir. He took the wealth that he gathered and he joined the forces of the kufr. Scholars write, he committed 3 crimes. One is, he killed a person unjustly. Number 2, he abandoned his Islam, he became renegade, and he had a lot of slave girls. He used to incite them to sing vile poetry about Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And these were the crimes he committed. Nabi alayhi salam said at the conquest of Makkah, and he also made this announcement, that listen, O people, Allah has made Makkah sacred. It is not correct for any man to kill anyone. However, at this critical moment, Allah has made it lawful for me to kill certain kuffar. It would not be correct for any person in the years to come to say that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam killed, hence I can kill. Nabi alayhi salam made it very loud and clear in the khutbah that he delivered in the khutbah, in the haram, that Allah has made it lawful for me, and after I have killed these certain kuffar, once again the sanctity of the Kaaba will return, and hence no life and bloodshed can take place in Makkah. Abdullah ibn Khatal comes in the Kaaba. Sahaba say, O Nabi of Allah, here is Abdullah ibn Khatal. Nabi alayhi salam said, wherever you see him, behead him. This is an evil man. Riwayat suggests between Hajr Aswad and Maqam Ibrahim, this kafir was beheaded. Another kafir that the Nabi of Allah had given the command that he must be beheaded, and this is where I want to explain the pardon of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, was Ikrama. Ikrama was the son of Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl was the Fir'aun of this ummah. ومن الناس من يجادل في الله بغير علم ولا هدى ولا كتاب منير. He had committed the most evil of crimes. At the conquest of Mecca, he decided to flee from Mecca for his safety. He leaves Mecca, boards a boat, and he goes to Yemen. His wife, Umm Hakim bint Harith bin Hisham, comes and accepts Islam. And she says, Ya Rasulallah, إن عكرمة قد هرب منك وخاف أن تقتله فأمنه. O Nabi of Allah, my husband, Ikrama, my father-in-law was a very evil man, Abu Jahl, he had caused a lot of pain to you. My husband is also afraid you will kill him, and he has fled from Mecca. I am asking you, kindly forgive him and pardon him. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says, Huwa amin, I have forgiven him. In one word, Nabi alayhi salam said, I have forgiven him. When this Ikrama gets onto the boat and he's sailing towards Yemen, they foresee a storm. He starts turning to his deities. The other people told him on the boat that, you know what, here your deities will not help you, here you have to turn to the true Allah. Like I always say, there is no atheist on a sinking ship. Oh my God. فَإِذَا رَكِبُوا فِي الْفُلْكَ Man turns to some deity. You will have to worship that one Allah. So he makes an agreement with Allah in the center of the ocean. In center of the ocean, اللهم لك عهد إن عافيتني مما أنا فيه. Oh Allah, if you grant me deliverance from this crisis in my life, when I will get to shore, I will pledge my loyalty and my allegiance to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he comes back to the shore, his wife comes to embrace him, and she says, يَبْنَ عَمْ جِئْتُكَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَبَرِّ النَّاسِ وَأَوْصَلِ النَّاسِ وَخَيْرِ النَّاسِ I have come to you from the noblest of people, and that is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Don't destroy yourself, come and accept Islam. So he agrees, and as they are coming back to Mecca, riwayat suggests, he then tells his wife, you know what, I have a need for you and I want to have some conjugal relation with you. His wife openly declines and she says, I have accepted Islam, you're a kafir, we can't have relation. They come to Nabi alayhi salam. He knows the wrong he has committed. He sits before Nabi alayhi salam. He says, Oh Muhammad, my wife. And she was totally veiled. She accepted Islam and she donned the hijab. Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my wife claims to say you have forgiven me. Nabi alayhi salam says, yes, I have forgiven you. The claim of your wife is totally correct. Then he asked Nabi alayhi salam, what do you invite? Nabi alayhi salam read the kalima and he embraced Islam. He then asked Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, make dua. Another thing I wanted to mention, before he comes in the gathering, look at the pardon of Nabi alayhi salam. Unfortunately today we are carrying a lot of grudges in our hearts. You know, each man is grudging this one over petty things. There's so much sourness in the heart. Although you forgive, you meet, you greet, but the hearts are not clean. Nabi alayhi salam said, يَأْتِيكُمْ عِكْرَمَةُ مُؤْمِنًا فَلَا تَسُبُّوا أَبَاهُ O my sahaba, Ikrama, the son of Abu Jahl, will be coming as a Muslim very shortly. When he comes here, don't taunt him about the wrong of his father. For verily, insulting the deceased offends the living. For verily, insulting the... فَإِنَّ سَبَّ الْمَيِّتُ يُعْدِ الْحَيِّ وَلَا يَبْلُغُ الْمَيِّتُ Then he tells Nabi alayhi salam, make dua. Nabi alayhi salam makes dua. Now this kafir, Ikrama, he was just not the son of a great kafir, but he himself had caused a lot of pain to Nabi alayhi salam. Nabi alayhi salam made dua, Allahumma ghfir lahu kulla adawatin adaniha, wa kulla masirin sara fihi ila mawdi'in yuridu bithalika al-masir itfa anurik, wa ghfir lahu ma nala minni min irdin fi wajhi aw ana ghaibun anhu. Oh Allah, forgive this man every hatred he displayed to me in Islam. Oh Allah, forgive him every step he took towards extinguishing your life. Allah, forgive him every time he insulted me on my face or in my absence. It comes in a riwayat, the sahabi started crying, he accepted Islam. He said, Oh Nabi of Allah, I have done so much to you, but you can forgive me. Indeed, you're the Nabi of Allah. Another kafir that the Nabi of Allah, listen to this, brothers. I call upon the woman. Today, mother-in-laws can't forgive daughter-in-laws can't forgive mother-in-laws. I'll show her on the day of Qiyamah. Look at the vastness of the quality of kindness in the life of your Nabi. Amongst the people that the Nabi of Allah said must be killed, one was a person called Habbar bin Aswad. I beg for your undivided attention, brothers. This is an incident that will make you cry. The Nabi of Allah, after he got married to Khadija radiallahu anha, after 5 years of this relation, Allah blesses him with his first daughter, who was called Sayyidatina Zainab radiallahu anha, the eldest daughter of Nabi alayhi salam. Every father understands the sentiments he has towards his eldest daughter. As this girl grew up and she matured, there was a person in Mecca by the name of Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi. This was prior to the advent of Islam. Khadija radiallahu anha liked this man as a son-in-law. So she asked Nabi alayhi salam, what do you feel? Can we get our daughter Zainab married to Abu al-As? Wa kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam la yukhalifuha. Nabi alayhi salam would not go against the desire of Khadija in a hurry. Nabi alayhi salam said, Khadija, if you feel it's a good match for our daughter, I am happy and we perform the nikah. Hence this marriage took place, and Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam got his daughter Zainab radiallahu anha married to this person called Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi. When Nabi alayhi salam received prophethood and he became the Nabi of Allah, at the advent of Islam, his wife and all his daughters accepted Islam. Of course, his son-in-law did not accept Islam. And the kuffar tried every way to persecute Nabi alayhi salam to such an extent that they came to the son-in-law of Nabi alayhi salam and they told him, Fariq sahibatak, you must divorce your wife. How can you have this man's daughter in your nikah? They cause harm and pain to Nabi Islam on every possible level. They said, divorce this man's daughter. He said, no, I will not divorce my wife. She hasn't done me any harm. As time continued and it became difficult, the Muslims made hijrat. The Muslims migrated from Makkah to Medina. I'm cutting a long story short. Nabi alayhi salam also made hijrat to Medina Munawwara. The first battle that was fought against the kuffar was the Battle of Badr. In the Battle of Badr, Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi, the son-in-law of Nabi alayhi salam, because he had not yet accepted Islam, also joins the ranks of the kuffar. Although he was not so anti-Islam, but because he had not yet accepted Islam, he came with the kuffar. And he was amongst those that were captured as the prisoners of war. It was then decided amongst the Sahaba with the consent of Nabi alayhi salam that the prisoners can buy their freedom with ransom. And the relatives from Makkah came and paid money, paid dirhams, gave jewelry. The daughter of Nabi alayhi salam, Zainab radiallahu anha, is in Makkah and she knows that her husband has been captured by the Muslims in Medina. She sends a very valuable necklace of hers which she received from her late mother Khadija radiallahu anha. And this necklace was brought before Nabi alayhi salam. Riwayat suggests, brothers, Nabi alayhi salam was sitting with his Sahaba. When that necklace came, he started crying like a baby. Raqqalaha riqqatan shadida. And he started cherishing the thoughts of Khadija. And he said, is this the desperation of my daughter Zainab back in Makkah? He asked the Sahaba, if you allow me, I return this necklace back to my daughter and I release my son-in-law without ransom, subject to your permission, but it's very emotional for me. Sahaba said, O Nabi of Allah, by all means, if you say we are happy. Nabi alayhi salam calls his son-in-law and he says, take this necklace and go and give it back to my daughter. And I'm setting you free. I only have one thing. When you go back to Makkah, send my daughter back. She is a Muslim. Makkah is not conducive for her now. The environment is hostile. Send my daughter back. He goes back and he agrees. And Nabi alayhi salam praised him regarding this. Haddathani fa sadaqani wa wa'adani fa wafabi. That he was a very faithful and loyal son-in-law to me. He comes back to Makkah. He tells the daughter of Nabi alayhi salam, that is his wife, look here, your father has, you know, set me free without taking anything. And your father said that you must go back to Makkah. Go to Medina. She got very happy that she can come and join Nabi alayhi salam. He makes adequate preparations. She mounts onto her camel. And Nabi alayhi salam sent two sahaba, Hazrat Zayd ibn Haritha and another sahabi. He said, disguise your movements. Come to a location. Try and make some mediation. Meet my daughter at this point. And then using an unusual route, bring my daughter back home. When the daughter of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mounts onto her camel, the son-in-law of Nabi alayhi salam could not come, so he sends his brother, Kinana ibn Rabi. And he says, just take my wife on the outskirts of Makkah, and then from there others will take her onwards. As she mounts onto her camel, she is pregnant, she is making hijrat on the Nabi, on the deen of Allah. As she comes to a certain location, the Tuwa, the riwayat suggests, some kuffar seen that the daughter of Muhammad is making hijrat, we cannot allow this, let us attack. One kafir by the name of Habbar ibn Aswad comes. Allahu Akbar, he comes and he strikes the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She falls off her camel. She was pregnant. فَوَقَعَتْ عَلَىٰ سَخْرَةٍ. She falls onto a boulder. As soon as she falls onto this boulder, immediately she miscarries the child who is the grandchild of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She starts bleeding so profusely that her condition is not stable. She cannot resume the journey. And this kafir and others are sitting and they enjoying what has happened. She's then returned to Makkah. Her condition is stabilized. And after a few days, she comes back to Makkah. She comes to Medina. But of course, her condition and her health was not too good. The incident is very long, brothers. She then comes to Medina. And in due time, then her husband also comes to Medina. And he accepts Islam. When he comes to Makkah, when he comes to Medina, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is very happy. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you know, performs the nikah between them two again. And they live happily and merrily. In Medina, the eighth year of Hijrah, Sayyidina Zainab radiallahu anha dies out of that same wound that she sustained in the journey of Hijrat, which the Nabi of Allah said, Khairu banati usibat fiya. This is my best daughter, she suffered the most for me. She comes to Medina and she stays there, and because of this wound, she passes away. Sahaba used to refer to her as a martyr because of the difficulty she experienced in Hijrat. And one other point I must mention, while she was being lowered into her grave, Nabi alayhi salam was so sad, he stood by the side, he told Umm Salma to give ghusl, and when the ghusl was over, he took out his own Mubarak cloth, and he says, now put this on the body of my daughter. And then when he went into his qabr, sahaba say he was so sad, we didn't have the courage to look at him, never mind us. He lowered his own daughter with his hands, and when he came out of the qabr, somehow his face was radiant, and it was bright. We said, O Nabi of Allah, what is the matter? What is the matter, O Nabi of Allah? Nabi alayhi salam said, as I was going into the grave, I looked at the darkness of the grave and the loneliness of the grave, and I thought of the weakness of my Zainab. I was really worried about my daughter. What is going to happen to my daughter in the qabr? I mean, dua to Allah, Allah, what's going to happen to my daughter? Make it easy for my daughter. And the angels have descended to confirm my daughter will be exempted from hisab. As a token of joy that my Allah has accepted and exempted my daughter from the severity of the grave, my face is radiating. Brothers, in a nutshell, at the conquest of Makkah, my Nabi said, kill the man who assassinated my daughter, Habbar ibn Aswad. But this man also comes running before Nabi alayhi salatu was salam. The man who put a spear through the body of Zainab, who caused the grandchild of Nabi alayhi salam to die. He comes, sahaba say, O Nabi of Allah, ya is Habbar. They withdrew their swords. Nabi alayhi salam says, wait, give the man a chance. They talk of presidential pardon. I swear by Allah, neither the skies nor the earth has seen a more forgiving human than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who can shelter the murderer of his own daughter. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam says, what do you want to have to say? Say, he says, O Nabi of Allah, I know I have done this pain to you and I've hurt you. And I was going to flee from here, but then I heard you're a very kind man and you're a very forgiving man. You're a very merciful man. And hence I have come. فَاسْفَحْ عَمَّا كَانَ يَبْلُغُكَ عَنِّي. I have one thing to ask you, and that is forgive me for the wrong that I have done to your daughter. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam sighs. Brothers, can we imagine? I don't have time to elaborate. Can we translate the sentiments of Nabi alayhi salam in any possible language? Nabi alayhi salam sighs and he says, I have also forgiven him, and my sahaba, you also forgive him. Brothers, this was the kindness and the forgiveness of Nabi alayhi salam. His uncle, who was assassinated in the battle of Uhud, Nabi alayhi salam cried at this occasion so much, riwayat suggests he never cried in his life. He made the janaza namaz of Hamza 72 times. And you know what? When his body was mutilated, he said, if it wasn't for the fear of my auntie Safiya, I would have left the body of my uncle Hamza on the floor. And he was the foster brother of Nabi alayhi salam. They both drank the milk of a nursing mother called Thuwaiba. Nabi alayhi salam said, if it wasn't for the sentiments of my auntie, I would have left the body of Hamza on the floor so that the vultures should come and eat on his body and that he can stand up and be resurrected from the stomachs of the vultures on the day of Qiyamah. To add to the helplessness of his situation on the day of Qiyamah, the man who assassinated him at the conquest of Makkah, Nabi alayhi salam said, kill this man. But even this man knew that the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is such a forgiving Nabi. He comes before Nabi alayhi salam and he sits there. Nabi, the riwayat of Bukhari, he asked Nabi alayhi salam, O Nabi Allah, forgive me. 8 years has left, but the grief is fresh. Nabi alayhi salam says, you are Wahshi? He says, yes, I am Wahshi. Anta qatalta Hamza? You killed my uncle Hamza? He looked down, he says, yes, I killed. Nabi alayhi salam says, how did you kill my uncle? Tell me. He says, I don't have the courage to tell you. Nabi alayhi salam says, okay, I forgive you, but do me one favor, don't show me your face. Every time I see your face, it revives the thoughts of the murder of my uncle. فَإِنْ اسْتَطَعْتَ أَنْ تُغَيِّبَ وَجْهَكَ عَنِّي. If you can just avoid your appearance, it will make it easy. But I have forgiven you also. Brothers, there are so many ahadith. I take this opportunity to ask every brother, let us leave this gathering by forgiving. Let us clean our hearts. How long will we keep malice, jealousy, grudge? Let us then relate to the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who could shelter the murderer of his daughter, who could shelter the person who assassinated his uncle. In one hadith, Nabi alayhi salatu wasallam says that that person who will forgive his brother for the pleasure of Allah, he will enjoy the greatest abodes in Jannah. As I mentioned, this is just but one quality. May Allah ta'ala inspire us with the beautiful akhlaq of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we can also learn to forgive our partners. One Nabi complained to Allah, my wife has very evil character. Allah said that this is the share that I have put of difficulty in your way, that you endure and you forgive. Allah speaks about forgiving in the Quran. فَاسْفَحِ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِينَ. Overlook in a good way. Forgive in a good way. We know about a beautiful house and a beautiful car. Allah speaks about beautiful forgiveness. That is forgiveness in such a way that you don't make reference or you don't grudge in the heart. Allah inspire us all.